Hello everyone, welcome back to the session on pila globosa. We have been discussing on the different organ systems of pila globosa, the apple snail, and here we are going to discuss on the respiratory system. Pila, as we have already seen, it is an amphibious mollusk, that is, it is adapted to for a life in water as well as on the land. And to suit its the amphibious life, it shows or it exhibits two modes of respiration, and that too very effectively. They take up what you call aquatic respiration with the help of tinea or gills, and aerial respiration with the help of pulmonary sac or lungs. Here in this figure, you can see the tinea, the gills over here, which helps in the aquatic respiration, and the pulmonary sac. In the pulmonary chamber, it helps in aerial respiration. Okay, now we will look into the structure of the tinea as well as how it takes up the respiration in an aquatic ecosystem. Okay, tinea, it is a monopectinate gill. Okay, this is just a two-dimensional view. It is extended, that you can see here, it is extended longitudinally like this, right? So tinea, it is a monopectinate gill. It is comb-like, and you can see it is situated on the right side of the branchial chamber. As we already mentioned, this is the branchial chamber. This is the epitinea, which divides the mantle cavity into the branchial chamber and the pulmonary chamber. And the tinea or the gill, it is present along the dorsolateral wall, the roof of the branchial cavity, okay, or branchial chamber. Fine. And as you can see, the tinea, it consists of a long axis. This is the axis which is known as the tineal axis. And the tineal axis, this is the part of the tinea which actually remain attached to the mantle wall. Okay, so it is the tineal axis which is attaching the tinea onto the roof, the dorsolateral walls. Right. Then we can see here, yeah. So this is the tinea, right? This is the tineal axis, and the tineal axis, it bears a long series of flat triangular leaflets. As you can see here, this is the tineal axis. Okay, so this may be the what you call part seen over here towards the dorsal side, and towards the anterior end down here, this may be the part. So this is how it is located, right? So when you look, this may be the posterior, this may be the anterior part. Okay, so these are the lamella, these structures. Okay, the lamella, they are triangular in nature, leaflets, and these are known as the tineal lamellae. And each lamellae, you can see it is attached by a broad base to the tineal axis. Okay, and another thing is like the free edges of the tineal lamella, they are not equal, they are unequal, isn't it? The shorter side you can see over here, and it is the longer side. Okay, all the lamellae, you can see it is not of equal size, right? Towards the extreme ends of the tineal axis, you can see the lamellae are smaller. Okay, while towards the center or the middle, the lamellae are larger. So in the middle of the tineal axis, the lamellae attached are larger, while the size of the lamellae, it decreases towards the two ends, right? The anterior and the posterior phases of each lamellae are provided with transverse ridges, or what is known as the transverse plates. Okay, the anterior as well as the posterior phases of each lamellae. Okay, on both the sides you can see the transverse plates. These contain branches of blood vessels through which the blood flows from the afferent blood vessel to the efferent blood vessel. That we can see what is the afferent and the efferent. Okay, here when you look into the tineal axis, this is a single lamellae enlarged. This is the tineal axis, the part of the tineal axis to which the base of the lamellae is attached. This is the tineal lamellae. Okay, so the tineal axis, you can see it is traversed by an efferent blood vessel. Okay, this is the flow of blood, or this one shows the flow of blood. So this is the vessel which is passing by. Okay, so the efferent blood vessel, you can see how, in which direction the blood is flowing. The blood is flowing into the gills. Okay, so the afferent blood vessel, it carries blood into the gill. So the blood which is going into the gill, it is taken for oxygenation. So it is the deoxygenated blood which passes through the afferent blood vessel. Okay, so the afferent blood vessel, it carries deoxygenated blood to the gill, and then the oxygenated blood, it is being collected through the efferent blood vessel. Okay, this is the efferent blood vessel, and this efferent blood vessel, it takes the blood from the gills to the heart so that it can be pumped to various parts of the body. So this is how it is. Okay, now these are the blood vessels. You can see here it passes through the transverse bleeds. Okay, so now another thing is the part of the lamellae along which the afferent blood vessel moves or runs, it is known as the afferent side, and the other side along which the efferent blood vessel moves, it is known as the efferent side. Okay, now I hope till here it is clear to you. Okay, so the shorter side is the afferent side, the longer side is the efferent side. Okay, and as already mentioned, the transverse bleeds, it contains branches of blood vessels through which the blood flows from afferent blood vessel to the efferent blood vessel. Okay, so these are the blood vessels which are found in the transverse bleeds. Okay, so this is about the tenidium or the gills. Now we can see how aquatic respiration takes place. This is the picture which shows the respiration in water. Okay, the aquatic respiration, it usually takes place when the snail is in the water, isn't it? It's usually at the bottom aquatic ecosystem, or it is floating, or it is suspended in water, or if it is attached to water plants or weeds. Okay, so this is the time when it takes up aquatic respiration, and during this time what happens is the animal is found to be fully expanded with the head and the foot fully extended. You can see over here the head and the foot is completely extended while it is taking up the aquatic respiration. Okay, and here you can see this is the left nuchal lobe and this is the right nuchal lobe, and this is the epitinia. Okay, this part is the mantle cavity. Okay, and this is the epitinia. Epitinia is the longitudinal ridge which divides the mantle cavity into two chambers. This part is the pulmonary chamber and this is the branchial chamber. Okay, now the branchial chamber opens out through the right nuchal lobe while the left nuchal lobe opens into the pulmonary chamber. Right, so during the aquatic respiration, the two nuchal lobes, they form channel like structures. The left nuchal lobe, it forms like a channel which through which the water moves inside. You can see the water in current. Okay, this arrow shows the direction of water inflow. Okay, so you can see water flows inside. Okay, and the water which moves inside, it flows in contact with the ostradium. You can see here ostradium, right? And what is the function of ostradium? It actually checks the quality of the water, right, with respect to the chemical, with respect to the food, etc. So here you can see it moves over in contact with the ostradium to the pulmonary chamber. So it has entered the pulmonary chamber, right? Now the epitinia is a ridge, right? Over here what happens is the water will cross over the epitinia, okay, moves over the epitinia, the ridge, and it enters the branchial chamber. And you can see here it has reached over here, and the water will move over the complete length of the tenidium. This is the tenidium. Okay, so it will wash the complete lamellae of the tenidium, and it flows out through the right nuchal lobe, water excrement. Okay, so when the water moves over the tenidium, there is gaseous exchange taking place, right? And this is actually what happens is the blood vessels that supply, the branches of blood vessels supplying the gill lamellae or the tenidial lamellae, it is in contact with the water. And this water, which has entered the branchial chamber from the pulmonary chamber, will have good amount of oxygen, and the oxygen diffuses into the blood vessels in the tenidial lamellae, and in turn the carbon dioxide moves out. So there is a efficient gaseous exchange taking place during this time. Okay, so this is how the aquatic respiration takes place. Now, how this water keeps on moving? Water is kept moving with the help of the beating of cilia. You can see over here the cilia present. This is actually a single lamella, the section of the transverse section of a single tenidial lamellae. Okay, so you can see here on the outer side they do have the cilia. So the beating of the cilia on the lamellae, it will keep the water moving. Okay, so that is what the one important feature is about. Okay, now we can go into the next respiratory structure, that is a pulmonary sac. Okay, so aquatic respiration, we saw the structure of tenidium, we saw the aquatic respiration. The next is the pulmonary respiration, pulmonary sac. So as we have already seen, pulmonary sac is a bag-like structure. It is developed from the mantle wall and it hangs from the roof of the mantle cavity into the pulmonary chamber. And the pulmonary sac, you can see it opens into the pulmonary chamber by way of aperture, which is known as a pulmonary aperture or the pneumostome. Okay, this is about the external structure of the pulmonary sac. Now going into how the respiration is brought about, that is during aerial respiration, how the pulmonary sac helps in respiration. So during the when do the aerial respiration take place? When the animal is completely on land, or it may be in water but very close to the water surface, so that the respiratory siphon, it can project out through into the air. Okay, the respiratory siphon, it can roll up and it can open above the water surface. Okay, so in such cases the aerial respiration can take place. So the aerial respiration is observed when the animal is in water, very close to the water surface, or it is completely on land. Okay, and when it is in water, it the left nuchal lobe, it will roll up and it forms a respiratory tube-like structure, and this is what is known as a respiratory siphon. Okay, and the respiratory siphon may project above the water surface, and through this the air will enter the pulmonary sac. Okay, pulmonary chamber, and from there it may enter the pulmonary sac through the pulmonary aperture. Right, the air always moves through this path. Okay, so here you can see the air current, right? So this is the pulmonary sac which is shown, and inside the pulmonary sac you can see it opens into the mantle cavity through the pulmonary opening or aperture, right? So here you can see the wall of the pulmonary sac, it is supplied with branches of blood vessels, so it is a very effective respiratory structure. And the here another thing is, when the animal is taking up aerial respiration, usually what happens is the epitenia over here, the epitenia, it is completely raised to the mantle wall. Okay, so it is raised and it forms a complete septum which completely separates the branchial chamber from the pulmonary chamber. So the air which enters through the left nuchal lobe, it will remain inside the pulmonary chamber itself. It cannot pass over the epitenia onto the branchial chamber. Okay, so that is one specific feature what is seen during the aerial respiration. So the air always moves through the respiratory siphon into the pulmonary chamber, from there through the pulmonary aperture or the pneumostome into the pulmonary sac. And from there, once the gaseous exchange is over, the air will move out through the pneumostome. It enters the pulmonary chamber, and from there, through the respiratory siphon, it moves out. Okay, so this kind of you can see the inflow as well as the outflow of air. It is maintained by with the help of alternate expansion and contraction of the pulmonary sac. Okay, here the cilia on the tenidium cannot help in keeping up the flow. Over here, this is by way of the contraction and relaxation of the pulmonary sac. Okay, So this is how it happens. What